Welcome to Oregon Voters Digest, the program that brings forward the social and political issues that are important to people living here in the Pacific Northwest. And now, your host, Bruce Broussard.
Broussard. As you know, folks, we're right in the midst of the election. I mean, we're right there, and this is the last leg, if you will. And it's so important, if you will, especially during these times, because the times that we're having some very interesting times from a national perspective, local perspective. It's really tough. When one starts thinking about jobs, the economy, education, national defense, and then the other issue about those folks who are sitting up in office and been there for so long, it's called term limits, and we're trying to figure out what can we do about the response, if you will, to the issues that we have as citizens of Oregon. Well, I guess what I'm going to be doing from this point on is actually introducing and discussing with individuals that I feel very comfortable with and that I will be supporting in the upcoming election, because they basically are able to identify with each of the issues that I'm going to be talking about. It's very, very important for Oregonians. And so I'm going to start off with my first guest will be Art Robinson. I'm sorry, right off the bat, I'm running so hard. Anyway, Art and I we go back quite a ways. I've had him on the show on a number of occasions. You can check out some of the interviews I've had with him before, on the YouTube and et cetera. But what we're going to do today, he happens to be a candidate running in District 2 for Congress. And I tell you, he's a very dynamic person, very honest person, a very neat person. I've worked with him very closely, and I think you're going to be excited about it. So with that ado, I'm just going to interview Art. How you doing, Art?
Doing fine. Thank you.
Sounds great. Why don't we just jump right into this in terms of what are some of the issues that are facing Oregonians and how you react to them? Is that okay with you?
Sure, it's great.
Okay. But before that, I think for the benefit for those who are just maybe watching or whatever, I just want to just give them a little quick introduction of Art Robinson.
Well, I've been, Bruce, I've been living in Oregon for 33 years. My wife and I were both scientists, and we wanted to raise our children on an Oregon farm. So we found a beautiful one in Josephine County and moved our research lab there, and some of our colleagues helped us, and it's kind of an unusual place, a farm with a research laboratory, biochemistry. And we had six children, wonderful life there. Unfortunately, in 1988, she died. So the children and I grew up together there. Mm-hmm. They all became scientists, or two of them are veterinarians, the rest are scientists. And we've had a great time. Oregon's a wonderful place to live. Mm-hmm. But we never expected to be in politics, but things in the country have become so critical, so difficult for people, that we felt it was our duty to work on it for a little while. We work on medical research. Mm-hmm. We do that as a duty. We like biochemistry, and we do the medical research because we feel we have a duty to help our fellow man. And when you see the political situation we have today, you have a duty to try to help that too.
Right.
So we thought our district needed a new congressman, because
yes,
the one we has been there for 27 long years.
Right.
So we decided to try to replace him.
Okay, good. In fact, let's take a part of that in your introduction in regards to when you said your wife passed away, and all of a sudden you're left with six kids, and they're young in many ways, and there's an education issue that you have to deal with.
That's right.
Besides the profession that you're dealing with.
That's right.
How did you deal with that in the education? How did you get involved, and why?
Yeah, well, when Laura Lee died, the youngest was 1.5 years, and the oldest was 10. And we had to take care of that. And she had wanted very much to educate them herself, so we were homeschooling. And so we continued to do that. And in fact, we built a family business, the children did, when they got older, and we now have 60,000 students around the country that use, not all homeschool students, a lot of public school students use our curriculum as a supplement. But children need to be educated by the community. Mm-hmm. And the schools I went to when I was growing up, the schools that you went to, were the best in the world. American schools were not second to no one. They were all local schools. The community, the teachers, the students, and the parents ran those schools. And they were terrific. And when Laura Lee and I were thinking about who would educate our children, we were worried, because the schools aren't local anymore. They're controlled by Washington and Salem. And government-controlled schools, where bureaucrats run the schools instead of the parents, the teachers, the students, and the community, tend not to be as good, because they don't know the students, they don't know the teachers, they don't know the situation. They aren't concerned about the discipline and the accomplishments of the children. So lacking that, we decided we'd homeschool our children. I wish we wouldn't have had to do that. Mm-hmm. Homeschooling has grown. As the schools have deteriorated, homeschooling has grown. If we get the school system back on track, there'll be no need to do it. But we like to teach. I taught at the university. We both love to teach, and we decided to do it that way.
You know, as you know, the situation that we have in Oregon, we do have issues with our education here in the state of Oregon aspect of it. And so how would you address this issue in regards to representing us in Congress?
Well, in Congress, you know, Oregon has some superb schools and some poor schools. And on average, it's not good. It's about 40th in the nation. And as I mentioned, the nation isn't standing very well in the world now. And I think anything that's done to put those schools back under the control of the parents, teachers, community, and students is a move in the right direction. So what I'd like to see done is that the, and you can't do everything at once, right. So I can describe what I'd like to see done, but you, in Congress, you have an opportunity to do a little bit. You compromise, you don't go in there and say, it's gonna be my way. But the general direction I'd like to see us move is where the federal education money goes right to the locality. From scholarships to operating expenses, and where the state education money goes directly to the community. And the people in the community, we've got tens of thousands of great teachers. We get the great teachers, the community leaders that care about our schools, the parents, and of course the students too. They have a big stake in it. You can't fool a young person into thinking he's getting education when he's not. And those four, the community, the locality, I'd like to see the resources transferred to them as they were 50 years ago when you and I went to school. I think we'd be better off.
You know, and naturally, the major concern of many Oregonians is the results.
That's exactly
the bottom
right.
line is the results.
And the results aren't good.
Okay, right.
So we got to change it.
Okay. And how does public school fit in this particular?
Well, I'm talking about public school.
Okay.
Our public schools started, well, our schooling started on the frontier.
Right.
On the frontier, there were three books. Mm-hmm. The Bible, Pilgrim's Progress, and Shakespeare. Mm-hmm. And literacy was almost 100%. The people loved to read, but they had three books. You couldn't get books. And then it went on through the one-room schoolhouse. That was like two or three farmers would hire a teacher for their kid. And then the community schools, which developed through World War II, the schools we went to. All of this was local. All of it was controlled locally. The states were very marginally involved and the federal government not at all. And we had the best schools in the world. And I owe my whole life to them. I went to a great public school and that got me into Caltech and I got a whole career in life and science. It was wonderful.
Well, yes, that's a good point you raised because at the end of the day, like you said, is that people are going to be looking at results mm-hmm. and then therefore that translate into jobs, their ability
job,
to get a
everything.
Job. And you know, in Oregon right now, it looks like there's a struggle, if you will.
I'd say that if we can get these schools back on track,
right.
One indicator will be how many homeschool students we have. It mm-hmm. should go down. Because we got great schools. But today, parents who can, a lot of them choose private alternatives. We know that public schools work because they worked for this nation for 200 years. But today they're not working. And educators like myself have some pretty strong words to say about that. Mm-hmm. There are 50 million children in those schools today, and it's not a good thing that we aren't giving them the best possible educations.
You know, many Oregonians are concerned about, we have such a beautiful environment that we live in, whatever. And many, many families, if you will, would like to keep their families together,
That's right.
And so therefore the creation of jobs and the economy, if you will.
Exactly.
How would you address the economy?
Well, that's it's a similar problem. The central government, they want to run a huge central government. So they have high taxes. Oregon has the highest corporate taxes in the country, I think. Then you add in regulations. You got millions of bureaucrats telling people what to do. As a consequence, it's hard for an entrepreneur to function. It's hard for a small businessman to succeed. I talked to a lady the other day. She and her husband run a restaurant. They have 11 employees. This lady looked tired, worn out, and she just kept telling me how hard it was to satisfy the regulations from the state. And to pay the bills after the state had taken a big part of their earnings in taxes. And you need to get the government off the backs of our job creators so that we will have jobs. Mm-hmm. And we need to give our children great educations that are relevant to the jobs. Mm-hmm. And we're going to have to do it ourselves because the government's not going to do it for us.
You know, and you know, one of the things that you've always reminded me of as we've chatted through the times that I've known you is that you understand that the true definition of government from the standpoint is a government of the people, by the people, and
exactly.
for the people.
Exactly.
We were there at one point in time. Are you planning on bringing that back to the table?
Well, that's where we should be. That's
yes.
on the table.
Yes.
We have a government, and we need one. And the founders knew we needed one because you have to defend your country, and you have to defend justice. You need a system of justice. You need a system to help people who are in need. You need a government for many things. You can't function without a government. So they decided, but government is dangerous because it can go too far. So our founders created a government, and then they wrote a constitution to tell it what it couldn't do. It couldn't get in the way of our liberty. Couldn't get in the way of our freedoms. And if we follow those rules, we're in. But today we have people who in power who like to extend their power. And that is why we need term limits. Mm-hmm. You can take a man, maybe our current congressman, maybe the guy I'm running against, goes into Congress with very good ideals. He just wants to help. Once he gets there, if he gets the idea that that's a career, he wants to stay a long time, then what's important is what serves his career. Mm-hmm. During the first 100 years of our country, the average congressman served 2 years,
wow.
all volunteers, and it worked. Now the average is 12. The guy I'm running against has been there 27 years. When something comes up, he votes for him. Mm-hmm. And if it happens to be good for us, that's fine. And if it doesn't, well, too bad.
You know, another point that I found that through our discussion again, too, was the fact of the matter is the issues that are relevant during that particular mm-hmm. period are not being addressed, especially from an Oregonian standpoint.
Oh, yes.
in your district. Do you, as you were knocking around doors, were you hearing the same thing?
Oh yeah, every door, especially productive people, the people who work,
mm-hmm.
It's the same story. I can't pay my taxes and pay my bills. And when I try to do something, this inspector or somebody there caused me trouble, making the cost go up. And I'm worried about my children because they're not getting education that's going to enable them to get jobs. And I'm worried about the lack of jobs. It's everywhere. Everybody talks about the same thing. And the poverty in District 4 is a serious matter. District 4 is the size of Switzerland and has far many more natural resources than Switzerland. But the income's about a third. The mills are closed. People are out of work. It's terrible. You go door to door knocking doors and you find people that are just devastated. And you know what? Our congressman, he left that alone, didn't do anything for 25 mm-hmm. years, and then he decided he needed a forest plan because I was running against him.
Mm-hmm.
And I won in those districts, won in our counties, our rural counties. I won all the rural counties. But it's just, you need good representation in Congress.
Yes.
People in Congress need to know what the Northwest timber industry is like. I don't know whether even this guy even knows by now. He's been in Washington so long. But they have to be concerned about our situation. And our congressman has to be concerned about what happens here to our people, not what happens to his career.
Mm-hmm.
That's
mm-hmm.
the bottom line.
And I guess the other thing is that one has to be very creative because you know how to count.
Yeah, but most
there,
people do, you know?
Yes.
I say in speeches sometimes that we could go down any town in Oregon, pick the first 435 people we meet on the street, put them into Congress, they do fine. And the truth is, they do better than what we got. They've got, Americans have common sense. Yeah, you might pick up a guy that was unfortunate enough to be an alcoholic, and he might not be too much good to you, but he wouldn't hurt you.
Mm-hmm.
And he probably has some common sense,
yeah,
too.
Yeah.
Ordinary Americans were supposed, that's the way the Constitution, that's why they made the House of Representatives elected every 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
Citizen volunteers. And not just off the street. People would choose someone who'd been successful and was respected and known to be honest. And they'd go to him and say, it's your turn. And he'd say, well, but who's going to take care of my grocery store?
Mm-hmm.
But he's also sort of proud. They ask him, right?
Mm-hmm.
So he agrees to do it for a couple of years and they get somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
Common sense from the grassroots America is what was supposed to run our government.
Mm-hmm.
And now that common sense is left at home, and we get career people running the government, and every one of us turns on the television set and sees what's happening. Mm-hmm. And I'm running as a Republican. I have the Constitution Party nomination, but when I turn on the television set, I don't like any of those politicians. I think we need a clean slate.
You know, one of the major issues facing us today, for that matter, is the people's concern about national defense.
Yes.
I mean, we've gone through the Al-Qaeda situation under the present administration, and now we got a new situation with ISIS, as they say, these nomenclature aspect of it. But it's basically in the same sort of an arena aspect of it. And people are getting the feeling about being threatened, about the fact of the matter is we're going to have some of these bombings here in these United States and this, that, and that. They are nervous. And then the idea of all of a sudden we may have to go through another draft and put troops back in the deal and right up front with your families are worried about their kids going. And in all due respect, the poor kids going and the rich kids not. Mm-hmm. You know, at one point in time, we did have a draft and everybody was going. Yeah. Sometimes I think about it, if we did have the draft, I think we wouldn't have any wars.
Well, I'd like to see the congressman leading the charge out there.
Yes, there you go.
We'd give each one of them a platoon and send them out there.
I think that would make a difference.
They seem to, the people that like to get into these wars are often the people that don't go out and fight them.
Yes.
You have, it's wonderful. You served in Vietnam.
Yes.
Our country must be defended. We know what that means if the enemy is trying to invade the United States, but there are other circumstances where we see that to defend our country, we must do something else, somewhere else. But these decisions about where you serve, and around our country, we have many people proudly, you're wearing a Vietnam hat, you've served in Vietnam, people who served in all of our wars, took great risks, many families who've lost their sons and daughters in war, many injured veterans who go through their lives crippled because of war. But that's a price that must be paid for freedom, and they pay that price. Mm-hmm. And it's a terrible thing to ask them to pay that price, but they do. But we have to be sure that they get what they pay for. Mm-hmm. We have to be sure when our troops go in the field, they go because they need to, and they go to win. And one of the things in our Constitution that makes sure that happens is that the United States Congress must vote before you go to war. Mm-hmm. And that's been ignored. Mm. These things in the Middle East, I can't tell you which ones were wise and which ones weren't. I haven't been a congressman. I don't have security clearance. Mm. But I can tell you the Congress did not vote for any of those actions. Mm-hmm. And that's not good. Mm-hmm. Because if you have the people voting and you give the people the information, the congressmen, they're likely to make pretty wise decisions because many of them have sons and daughters that are serving too. Mm-hmm. But when you turn it all over to one man, not to say that President Obama's been wrong about everything, but when you turn it over to one man, you're less likely to get it right. Mm-hmm. And he's in a terrible situation now. You know, they've got all this trouble in the Middle East. It's horrifying to Americans. They don't want to come here. And this one man out there is trying to get it all right. Mm-hmm. And even if I don't agree with all his policies, but even if I agreed with them all, I would be scared for him because it's very hard to get it all right.
So your position would be that the Congress should be making that
Congress
decision.
Must make the decision. Okay. And what happens is we get career people and their first priority is their career. So they don't want to decide on war and peace. Mm-hmm. Because if it doesn't work out well, it's not good for them. Mm-hmm. So they turned all over to the president. But that's not the way the Constitution reads, and it's not the best thing for us.
Mm-hmm. You know, the other thing that comes to mind in regards to the whole issue of getting back in this war aspect of it, you think about equipment. Mm-hmm. And I think then there was a big announcement about the fact that a lot of the equipment that was coming out of Iraq was being given, if you will, to mm-hmm. police departments around the country. Billions and billions of dollars, if you will, that were given. Yeah. And then all of a sudden we're into this new war, and all of a sudden, guess what? We're asking the American people, we need more money,
right.
We got to buy more.
I know.
How would you have approached that piece?
I wouldn't.
Congress should have been involved in it.
Except in very rare instances, I wouldn't deploy military equipment in American cities and villages and homes. We don't have a country that needs that. We're not some third world country and a dictator is trying to run roughshod over us and he has to have soldiers in the street. So I don't like the idea, and I don't think it really helps our police departments to, because a police department is not just somebody to arrest people. They're social workers. Mm-hmm. You talk to a really good officer, sheriff or policeman, they spend most of their time just helping the community. You got some man that gets into trouble or some woman who gets into trouble, they look at him first as somebody who got into trouble, we need to help them. Mm-hmm. But they keep the peace, right? And they enforce the laws.
Right.
You don't do that from an armored personnel carrier. Mm-hmm. So I don't think military weapons belong in our cities and streets. And as far as what we should do with them after we use them somewhere, we should store them and use them again. Mm-hmm. I don't think we should be giving them away.
Mm-hmm. That would have quite an impact on the economy, the budget.
Yeah, right.
Because it's going to turn it around now.
What tyranny is a terrible thing,
yes.
And we don't have tyranny in the United States. 2 billion people in our world are still trying to lift themselves from poverty and tyranny, and our country has been the principal example that such people have followed. Mm-hmm. We must be an example. And that, to be an example, we don't put military equipment in our streets and spies listening to our telephones and so forth. That's not America.
Mm-hmm. You know, again, thinking about your door knocking, whatever, we talked a little bit about that, and from the standpoint, these were the issues, none of the issues, but in all due respect, the incumbent who's sitting there right now wasn't responding to these issues.
No.
And wasn't making comments, for instance, like, quote, where we're going to get the monies and things of that nature, right?
Yeah, well, in campaigning, he's like a lot of his fellow career politicians. Mm-hmm. They find it effective to try to scare the people about a challenger. After all, they're a known quantity. They're in Washington, they're not doing a good job, but they're there. A challenger is an unknown. People don't know him, and you have to go out and campaign and get them to know you. My opponent spent $2 million trying to scare people about me.
Mm-hmm.
He wasn't telling the truth, the main goal was to scare people. I try to talk to him about the issues and get him to debate. He just wants to tell people, you don't want to take a chance with this guy Robinson, he's scary.
Mm-hmm.
That's not good. That's not the way we should choose our legislators. But it's something they do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you want to run for office, you got to, like Harry Truman said, right. You have to stand the heat if you're going to be in the kitchen.
That's right. And you have good, fresh ideas that would be responsive.
And the main thing is, Art Robinson, I'm running for one seat in Congress.
Right.
And if I get it, I'll do a good job.
Right.
Our Congress, mm-hmm. our district would be better off. But it's not just one guy running. You have to have hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of citizens running for these offices, maybe thousands. But I'm convinced, I'm sure, that we can rely on the American people. And if our Congress is populated, as the founders intended, mm-hmm. with citizen volunteers mm-hmm. who don't stay too long, we'll be fine.
You know, I like that point because, you know, all due respect, Oregonians are really disappointed at this point in time as far as our representation.
Oh, sure.
And that's
are.
On both sides of the aisles.
Oh,
I'm talking about Democrats and Republicans.
Oh, yeah. No, I'm a Republican, but if we don't...
Yeah, I mean, we got the same situation with the other side, too, at times. They tend to react just for that moment, as opposed to looking at it from a long-term standpoint, and they're working together, so to speak, like they're struggling, they're like as if to say the only time that they, i.e., try to identify with Oregonians is during the election.
That's exactly right.
Am I right?
Yeah. When they get into office, they got to work together, all of them.
Yeah.
And if one party puts forth a good candidate, vote for him. And if they don't vote for
him. Right, right.
If the Republican Party puts forth a great candidate, vote for him. If he doesn't, vote for the Democrat. You've got to figure out which of the citizen volunteers that steps up and is put forward by a party. Maybe it's the Constitution Party or the Libertarian Party. The party is a mechanism to go out and, based on its principles, try to find good people to represent the American people. The best way to do that is get people that haven't been in Washington too long.
Yes, right.
And if the party puts forth a good person, good man or woman, vote for him. If he doesn't, don't vote for him.
How, in terms of term limits, let's talk about that for a moment, since that's a good point. In terms of term limits, how much time should a congressman? We got the Senate, and we got the Congress, we got the representatives. What do you think? How much
I
time?
Don't think. Well, thinking about myself,
mm-hmm.
if I win this election, I'll serve 2-year term. If I'm accomplishing things, I'm doing a good job. I seem to be accomplishing things. It looks like it's worthwhile having me there. And there's not somebody else in the district that would accomplish more, or that we think would. I think running a second term is a good idea.
Mm-hmm.
After two terms in Congress, you better have an awful good reason why you want to stay longer. Now, some people say it should be 6 years, 8 years, 4 years. I think you look at it and say, how much am I accomplishing? But if you get the idea that you need to be there 8 years, you better think about why you have that idea, because you're probably thinking you kind of like being there and you like the career. Mm-hmm. I don't think congressmen should get a lot of perks. Mm-hmm. You know, they get tremendous perks. In fact, a lot of the laws they pass, they specifically say they don't apply to them. This is crazy. So maybe I should say, if the guy likes being in Washington, we need a change. Because why would you go to Washington if you can live in Oregon? Mm-hmm.
Well, you know,
so if I find myself liking Washington, mm-hmm. you better get out of there right now.
Well, you've always made that statement to me from the standpoint that it has to be you have to represent the issues for Oregonians.
That's right.
The pertinent issues across the board during that 2-year period. And if you've got new issues that are relevant, if you will, you run again. But if you don't have the issues, then you just, i.e., just trying to basically saying.
I'm really concerned with what I see out there. When I tell you I understand the terrible time our people are going through in District 4 because of the poor economy, mm-hmm. that's true. But if I get a shot to work on that for a couple of years, you better see if I made it better. Mm-hmm. And if I didn't, get somebody else. Mm-hmm. And even if I did, after a couple of terms, get somebody else anyway.
That's a good point. Well, any lasting points that you may want to make to the people of your district?
It's wonderful to have your endorsement. I think that Americans and Oregonians are concerned about a lot of things. Tops seems to be, and I think it's true, jobs, education, and the military, because of this problem in the Middle East. All of them would be improved if we had term limits, so we had fresh minds thinking about it. And we have an election coming up. Mm-hmm. And I hope you'll consider voting for me. I hope your viewers will. I'm proud to have your endorsement. Now, the main thing is, let's get some people with wisdom and new ideas in Washington.
Well, I think
one thing
good.
I like to talk
yeah,
about.
Yeah, go on, sure.
I have a friend, Harrison Schmitt. He was the last man to land a vehicle on the surface of the moon. And he wants us to go to Mars. But he knows we need new people. The average person who worked on the moon program was 26 years old. Now, I don't think the age is so much important in politics, but new minds, new ideas. Mainly, look at the Congress we have, and look at the shape we're in. Mm-hmm. We need a new Congress.
Good. I think so, too. And in fact, in all due respect, Art, the reason why I'm endorsing you, and all the one main item of the four items, is the term limit aspect of it. I think, as far as I'm concerned, the incumbent's done his job. He's done a good job. We want to thank him very much. Thank you for your service. I mean, they've
it's
done
not
that
as
for me
bad
before.
As the military.
That's
you don't have to face the enemy.
That's right.
Thank him. And tell him it's time for somebody new, because his ideas aren't. We've tried his ideas.
Yeah,
some of them may have been good.
Yeah. Yeah.
But we need some new ideas, because we got new problems.
And a person like you would bring that with your background and your the kind of work that you do and some of the accomplishments that you've done in regards to education and the whole issue of the national defense thing. And I mean, just ran on and on and on the jobs aspect of it. Really, you do a good job. You do a good service, not only for Oregonians, but also for these United States.
Yeah, because it's a national office.
Okay. We want to thank you very much for
thank
that.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Good
thank
enough.
You.
Good enough. Folks, I'll tell you what we'll do. We're going to take a short break, and we'll be right back.
You are watching Oregon Voters Digest. This program can be seen again on these channels on these dates and times. Tell a friend. Thank you.
Welcome again, folks, to the Oregon Voters Digest. I'm Bruce Broussard, your host, and I tell you, you're going to enjoy this 30 minutes. Again, this we're right into the election aspect of it, and what we're going to do in this particular segment, we're going to get sort of an overview of from a Republican standpoint, who happens to be the chair of the Republican Party for the state of Oregon through Art Robinson, and we're going to kind of get an overview of what the election's looking like and what are some of the candidates are, what are some of the issues within the Republican Party. And then we're going to focus on an issue here within the Portland metropolitan area. And I guess along that line, we're going to focus on maybe something specific with Greg Benton. And Greg, you probably know Greg here quite a bit, but the bottom line, he's got an issue that Art has addressed it. He's going to address to it, talk to this issue and whatever. But I thought it'd be a good deal. So Art, welcome again.
Thank you.
Appreciate that very much. And Greg, thank you for being here with us.
Oh, well, thank great. You for having me on your show.
Sounds great. Well, look, Art, why don't you give us sort of an overview? You're the chair of the Republican Party. Boy, you got quite a job, you know, besides wearing this other hat. But well, I want to talk about Oregon as far as your Republican Party and the issues.
Well, Oregon has a lot of issues. Mm-hmm. Jobs, education, medical things. We're mm-hmm. talking about medicine, especially here. There are a lot of issues. And a lot of things that could be done better. Mm-hmm. And we're Republican Party has put forth some candidates which we think will do a better job than some of those in our opposition. Okay. But that's for the voters to decide. Mm-hmm. It's our job in the Republican Party to find great candidates to solve our state's problems and to enhance the lives of our people. Mm-hmm. There is no greater blessing than the chance to live a life upon the earth, the human
yes.
life.
Yes.
And we should do everything we can to optimize everybody's life. But that doesn't mean the Republican Party is, I mean, if we give you a great candidate, vote for him.
Yeah.
If we don't, mm-hmm. kick us and make sure we do next time.
Well, that I understand about
so
you.
We're just one part of the political process. Mm-hmm. And we try to get good candidates.
Right.
And in some of the cases, we really succeed. And please vote for him.
Well, you know, one of the things I want to do, and I want to commend you for this, Art, is that you're probably the first Republican that I've known, and I've been in the party for quite some time, mm-hmm. that's recognized in the metro Portland area. And, you know, as you know, the story goes, I saw you in the paper that Jeff Mayden yeah. had done the piece on you,
and Jeff,
I called you.
Remember Jeff that? Brought us together.
Yeah,
I don't know whether he's happy about that.
I think he really likes that. I really want to thank Jeff for doing
it. I have a lot of fun with him.
But, you know, we met, and then the next thing you know, all of a sudden I'm wearing a hat now in the party. Well, two for that matter.
You've got two hats.
Yeah, you might want to talk about it. You talked about an engagement chair. And you talked about the veterans chair, but the engagement yeah. chair was a very unique one because mm-hmm. too often with many of the parties, and from a historical standpoint, they've always had a minority representative or a Hispanic representative or this, that, the other.
You came
with a whole new tack. Why?
That's completely nuts because we're all Americans. Hmm. And if you look at the differences in these so-called groups we're supposed to be in, the differences are trivial. And if you look into the people, they are trivial. And the idea that you go to some part of the American people and say, I'm here to reach out to you, is ridiculous. In the Republican Party, I want us to go to every part of our state and say, we want candidates from your area. We want mm-hmm. candidates, mm-hmm. not votes. And the other side, the people that want to defeat us, all of us, they want to defeat all of us so they can run things. We're constantly dividing and dividing and dividing, and these divisions don't make any sense. So you and I agreed we'd say engagement. We want to engage all the people. I've had a lot of fun with you. I've met a lot of new people.
Yes,
met in this particular area.
Too,
yeah, you know, and in this area of Multnomah County, they're mostly voting Democrat.
Mm-hmm.
But I think if they knew us better, they wouldn't be doing that all the time. Mm-hmm. They'd be voting Democrat when there was a good Democrat, Republican when there's a good Republican, and Constitution when there was a good Constitution Party candidate. And the main thing, all we can do here is bring a message of American values, which we all share, and urge them to run candidates, the people in this community, just like the people in Cave Junction,
mm-hmm.
run candidates from your region that represent your values.
You know, the other area that you basically, again, the other announcement was the veteran chair, if you will, for the Republican Party.
You're the veteran chair and the engagement chair.
Well, you've motivated me. That's why I've got my hat on.
Well, I know you wear that hat a lot anyway.
Well, yeah, and I was definitely wearing it now aspect of it.
You're the perfect veteran.
And that's another recognition thing that I think is very important. And the Oregonians really, well, people around the country for that matter, and giving us sort of respect, if you will. And this president has basically identified with that area, too.
And they admire and respect and thank all our veterans.
Yes.
That's number one. And number two, they want our veterans to have everything we promised them.
Yes.
And these problems with the VA are a worry to everybody because that's an area where we've been falling down.
Yes.
We have to fix that.
Now, the other area was the area of the metro area, you know what I mean? And that's why Greg is here with us today, because that was an issue. It's a major issue, naturally, when you start thinking about some of the major metropolitan area. There's some major issues here within this area. So I brought Greg along because he's involved in one of those issues, and the fact of the matter is, you were the only one from either party that would be willing to sit down and listen to what we had to say here.
Well, you know, I spent my life in medical research, too. And I spent half my time spent in medical research.
Yeah.
And the reason is, I want the medical system to work better.
Okay.
And your issue is right down the line of things I've worried about all my life.
So we're going to give Greg an opportunity to kind of share with that what that issue was all about. Because it's not only it's an Oregon issue, but it's a national issue. Yeah. Greg.
We're talking about patient dumping.
Yeah.
And this is a
patient
major,
dumping.
Patient dumping from emergency rooms. My experience was at Emmanuel Hospital, but also Providence and University of Oregon Health Science Center. But I choose Emmanuel Hospital to sue because I had a viable case against it. I actually filed a suit in federal court. But I realized that a lot of people are having the same experience. And patient dumping is simply this. When you go to an emergency room, the hospital has a responsibility to give you a proper examination for what's wrong with you, give you a determination, and to treat you until you are stable. That doesn't mean that you can count know your name and count to 10. That means that you are medically stable. In my case, I actually was put out of the hospital while I was having a life-threatening experience. And if I had stayed out of the hospital, I would have died. They actually put me in a wheelchair, handcuffed me, rolled me out the hospital.
Wow.
A police officer literally picked me up, body slammed me down to the ground, brutalized me, and then they asked me if I wanted to go back into the hospital. I said, no, call me an ambulance. And I went to another hospital, which was Providence, and had to spend almost 2 weeks and have reoccurring episodes as a result. Without getting too much into my own personal medical condition, I found this was happening to a lot of people that I knew. So I did what I knew best, was file a civil litigation against the hospital. But then I found out that the state has a responsibility to monitor the hospital. A board called the Oregon Health Authority has the ultimate say-so on these type of complaints. You file a complaint through the state of Oregon Health Authority, and it is under the COBRA Act, which is that they, again, they cannot throw you out of the hospital. They have to treat you, and they have to treat you in a reasonable way. And the reason that I also came on the show is because there was a little girl who died just recently from Ebola.
Ebola, yeah.
E. coli infection, and she was in the hospital. They put her out. Chances are either she didn't have insurance or she didn't have the right kind of insurance. And that's why the hospital actually put her out. I don't know, but that's just my speculation. And this happened to a lot of folks. So I had your guys put up on the board the address and the name of the organization to contact. And any citizen can do this. You can do this online. You can go to the website. You complete an intake form, and you submit it. Now, here's what happens. The state is bound by federal law to investigate each and every one of these complaints. They also compile all the complaints into a committee. Those complaints, the worst they can do is charge the hospital $100,000 per incident. Now, they don't always charge them that much. It depends upon how egregious it was. I suspect that what happened to me, they should get the maximum amount, or they should get their certification to practice or to utilize emergency room services. And as I was talking earlier, it's the bureaucracy. Doctors were fine as long as you got into the doctor. Now, the emergency room doctor I saw who said, oh, you're not having what you were having, well, he's under pressure from administrators to say those type of things. Mm-hmm. So you have gatekeepers, and you find this all the time. You can't even get to a doctor from the gatekeepers. People are so discouraged from going to the hospital. And when you sit in the emergency room, like the one time you went with me, you saw all these people just sitting there.
That's right.
And I sat there for hours.
It was horrible.
It was horrible. And then they finally got there, and they said, oh, my God, we should take care of you. Mm-hmm. But you know, they kept me there and then they let me out at 4 in the morning, you know, something like that, when they could have took care of me at 8 in the evening when I was there originally. So these types of things are to keep people, or poor people, people without insurance, from coming into the hospital whatsoever and seeking services. We make it so terrible for you, you won't come in. So they're constantly violating the federal law. And you're right, I went to all of the agencies, I went to the governor. The only other support besides ART was the Merkel's office, Senator Merkel's office. They did provide support. I have to give them credit for that. But everybody else, they want to deal with it. It's in civil litigation. I went to the city about it, of course. No one in the city wanted to talk about it. They wanted to protect their ends. The hospital wants to minimize it. And it's so difficult to get an attorney to represent. Of course, you got to spend $10,000 to $20,000 to get an attorney to represent you. I don't have that kind of money, but I know how to develop those type of support for that kind of resource. That's why I'm advocating for people, rather than filing civil litigations, what might take years to they come to completion, file with the Oregon Health Authority and file immediately. You can do it as many times as you had the experience. It doesn't matter if it happened 10 years ago. You still should file the complaint so they'll know that these things are happening.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, that was the kinds of issues that, for instance, that we need to actually focus on. And that's why when I shared that with you, you jumped right on this piece and kind of said, "Well, look, well, that's one of the things that I may get some feedback on, because this is a national issue. It's not just a it's not just a local issue or just Northeast Portland or something like that.
No
this is real especially world. Distressing, because it is a medical ethic.
Yeah,
every doctor, no doctor will leave a person who is in distress unhelped, and I don't think 99% of our doctors have that ethic. Mm-hmm. There may be one or two bad ones, but." So the medical ethic, the medical principle, is you don't, the doctor will work himself to death practically to help anybody he can. And that ethic translates into our emergency rooms. Everyone who goes, and they shouldn't need a law.
Yes.
You don't need a law. It's going to be a law.
There is a law.
But the law just reflects the ethic that no one should appear in an emergency room and leave before, as you say, stable.
Yeah.
And that is what our doctors want. And what you suffered probably was caused by the bureaucracy.
Oh, absolutely.
And the government comes in, they have a law, but you have the bureaucrats, you know, there's a sea of bureaucrats. They're at the hospital and they're there to satisfy all the government things. The bureaucracy did that, the doctors wouldn't want it. They'd be mad about it.
Oh yeah, there's always a little person out there with a clipboard comes in. Do you have insurance? Do you have this and that and this and that? Oh, well, we can't treat you now. Well, that's totally in violation of the law. But no one is enforcing the laws, and that's the problem. The laws are on the books. Yeah. They can easily enforce the law. I'm sorry about that.
Okay.
They can easily enforce the law. The state attorney general can enforce the law.
Right. Yeah.
The hospitals themselves can self-regulate. The police officers who showed up, instead of trying to arrest me, which they didn't do, but they assaulted me, they should have arrested the people who put me out of the hospital, because they were violating the federal law. Now, how do we get people, the enforcers, to enforce? I don't know. Maybe we ask them to.
And who do you
want to
tell? And who you share? Yeah.
Who do you share it with? I mean, you tell folks, and that's why I filed the civil suit myself, not knowing how the process was. It wasn't easy to find out this information.
Okay.
You can pick up the phone and say, well, who do I call to file a complaint? No one knew. Everybody, I don't know. So being a constant researcher, I went through all the government steps and I called all the agencies personally. And when I was able to, and I actually found out the steps. And that's why when you see this pops up on the screen, you see the CG about the Oregon Health Authority and that intake form, please, if you had the same experience or someone in your family or a friend or someone that you know, please, file out that form. We'll see what happens.
Well, the government should not permit this, but also if somebody else should have been there as the press, the media.
Well, yeah.
The court of public opinion is a very powerful court.
That's why we're here.
That's why we're here.
And that's why you're here.
That's why the voters died.
And the court of public opinion.
And you are.
It's very powerful. And that can force the government to do its job.
Right.
And it can also force physicians to overcome the bureaucrats.
Yeah.
These physicians today, they're trapped behind enormous amounts of rules and regulations. They're afraid they'll lose their medical licenses if they speak up, but they must speak up. And so this is something that's not just unlawful, it is unethical, and it is intolerable to the public, and that should stop the practice.
Absolutely.
Now, the one other point I want to make also, too, in regards to the Greg issue aspect, hopefully that'll be another issue that you will probably consider taken down to the way, down the way there, and threw it out on the table. Yeah. But because of your background and whatever, well, the other issue that I'm thinking about is the urine test piece.
Oh, yeah.
Well, share that. I mean, I was really intrigued about how you laid that out. Because initially, Jeff thought it was something else. But
well, this is a field of research that Linus Pauling and I started in 1968.
Okay.
You know, you go to the doctor and he takes a urine sample.
Right.
Or breath. He doesn't take one, but we work on breath and urine. Could mm-hmm. be blood, too. It's harder to get hold of. But typically, they measure just a few things. Mm-hmm. One measurement of one substance and another, and each substance has a sort of normal range, and their books say if it's out of the range, you ought to consider. But modern technology has made it possible to measure many more things. Mm-hmm. Today, we can measure, with the machines in our laboratory, we can measure 10,000 chemical compounds in 1 minute.
Wow.
Quantitatively.
Wow.
So when you do that on a urine sample or a breath sample, you get a wealth of information about the metabolism, the internal chemistry of a human being. And this is a field of research we started. We invented it. It's a big field of research today. But it's gotten to the point where we can now use those machines to really help people's health for diagnostic medicine, and for preventive medicine, and for therapeutic medicine, to monitor therapy. But to use them, we must calibrate them. Mm. We have to find out, for example, if you wanted to see breast cancer 2 years before the woman knew she had it, because mm-hmm. cancer is a long-term thing, it comes mm-hmm. slowly, you need samples from people who got breast cancer, and you need the samples from them during the 2 or 3 years before they knew they had it.
Exactly, so you would build up a database.
So we go to the public and we say, would you put your urine in a sample bank and give us one every 6 months, and gradually we build up the test material we need. This is gonna revolutionize diagnostic medicine, and it's not just us. Mm-hmm. This particular field we started, and now for 40 years, scientists have been working on it. So we're using Oregonians, mm-hmm. building a bank of 15,000 people, and we started in Josephine County asking for volunteers by mail, and we got quite a few, and then we expanded, and now we have 8,000 volunteers. We need 7,000 more. But my opponent in the election thought that was pretty funny. It's not funny, it's important to improving people's health.
Maybe mm-hmm. it was over his head.
And we were already diagnosing cancer and breast cancer, multiple sclerosis, muscular dystrophy in the 1970s like this. But we were using techniques that were at leading edge science to the point where they were not applicable. You could mm-hmm. do them in the lab mm-hmm. at great effort. Now the methods are here that we can apply to the public. Mm-hmm. So we're going to work on that. And
you mentioned sickle cell at one point in time, and I'm thinking of, the thing that comes right now to the public is Ebola.
Yeah.
You know, the idea is that they have no idea of origin of the disease or this, that, and the other people that die. I think it was about 3,000 people to date died. But there was a serum that was here that two or three Americans were able to get.
We haven't had an opportunity to work on that disease, mm-hmm. but it's certainly important to develop high-tech, instantaneous methods for finding out whether the person's infected, mm-hmm. because the infection spreads rapidly, mm-hmm. and waiting until the person is ill doesn't help the people he mm-hmm. exposed while he was getting ill. Mm-hmm. So using the best technological tools to diagnose that disease is very important.
But you were mentioning an issue, a problem, i.e. with reference to some of the things that you were doing in that arena, in terms of being able to...
Well, yes, there are some funny laws.
Like grades.
We have lawmakers, right? They kind of run wild.
Yes.
But one thing is, you are not allowed to practice medicine or to give medical advice or to use any method that is not approved by the federal government. You got to be licensed and you've got to have approval. So we're doing this project and we ask people for these samples and we have cryogenic stories. It's really leading as research. But some of the people have a very logical thing. They say, well, if we participate and you see anything in our urine that looks interesting, will you tell us?
Mm-hmm.
Well, our research is not approved as a medical practice. And therefore, if we were to tell him, we'd be in violation of the law. They could put us in jail.
Okay, now.
And this is craziness. This is complete craziness. But it's the way it is. So we, moreover, we're doing it with the public, because if doctors collect the samples, they have special legal responsibilities that are very costly because they're medical practitioners. So I can ask you for a urine sample for our research, and you can give me one. If no money changes hands and I don't promise that I will help you in any way, that's lawful. Anything more, and we'd be in trouble. And if I told you that I would tell you if I found something in that sample, I'd be in trouble.
That doesn't make sense.
No, it doesn't.
It doesn't make sense, but that's the way the government is.
Well, maybe that's an issue.
That's why we need more common sense in government.
Yes. Fresh ideas taken to Congress.
Well, if a bureaucrat can stop someone from receiving medical care at a hospital, but a scientist can't help a person by telling them, I know there's something in your urine that you may need to get medical help for.
That's crazy.
Moreover, you know,
turned upside down.
Our research is all public property. It's done with contributions, and we're not in business and aren't going into business. Mm-hmm. But suppose we calibrate these procedures, then they need to be applied.
Right.
And any company that decides to apply them probably is going to wait 5 or 10 years and spend as much as $2 billion getting permission to apply them.
Jeez.
Because that's the way the government works today.
Jeez.
And that is a form of craziness.
Because I'm thinking about Greg, you know, in his situation right here. I mean, what if all of a sudden he gave you an urine sample, and all of a sudden, because all this other counteracting stuff can all of a sudden, from a futuristic standpoint, cause other issues.
Right.
Issues of...
You couldn't tell me.
Every man should be able to help any other man in any way he can.
Yeah.
And that, as I said before, there is no greater secular value than the opportunity to live a human life on the earth. Mm-hmm. Everything we do to enhance the life of another person, or even our own lives, anything we do to enhance human life is a good thing.
Right.
We shouldn't allow ourselves to have a government that gets in the way of that.
And well, tell me this, Art.
It fits all these issues.
Well, Art, tell me this.
All the
if you were, let's say, once you're elected to office from District 4 as a congressperson, will that be a venue, if an opportunity in Congress to be able to put that on the table and have the discussion?
Yeah.
Maybe even bring Greg there as a testimony.
You don't know how much trouble one person can cause.
we do, because that's what we're here for.
You're here for. But no, I mean it. If you go to Congress and your concern is do the best job you can.
Right.
Right.
And if you're going to be up for re-election in 2 years, but your interest is not getting re-elected, it's doing the best you can.
Mm-hmm.
You can do a lot of good.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah.
Now, firstly, if something is wrong there, you're going to be outspoken about it. Mm-hmm. You're not going to keep quiet to keep keep people happy so they give you campaign cash. Mm-hmm. And I believe that one congressman who does his job right, who has ordinary abilities, can be 10 congressmen.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
If he does it right, he can be the equivalent of 10. Mm-hmm. So you're not getting one vote out of 435. If you work really hard, I think you can be one vote out of 40, and that's worth going for.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, what comes to mind, not being redundant about this piece, you think this whole Ebola thing, you know, everybody's hearing about this, that, and the other, and people don't know what's going on, and people are traveling, and this, that, and the other. You can catch it anywhere, even outside of Africa, if you will, all over the place. But the research that you're doing, just urine samples, all of a sudden, if you were able to go through that whole testing and this, that, and the other, and all of a sudden you find, hey, look, here's the cause. This is all we need to do.
And you don't even have to find the cause. If you can find a way to trace it, you can see it quantitatively.
Yes.
If we could, and these techniques are laboratory techniques, but they need to become widespread.
Right.
If they were widespread, we make those measurements, you know, 10,000 substances measured quantitatively in 1 minute, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
If that was widely available as a medical technique, then we probably would... I think we'd almost certainly see a pattern for Ebola, and that would mean we could test the people in those communities and find out immediately when they were infected, intervene for them earlier, and lower the infections that they spread to others earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Technology has way outrun medical practice. Mm-hmm. We're talking about the technology that I'm especially interested in, but technology in general has run far ahead of the medicine that we have the opportunity to experience.
Mm-hmm.
And that's mostly because our government has gotten between our research and our people.
Mm-hmm.
It has good intentions. They say, we don't want anything to be used that might hurt somebody.
True.
And so we'll spend 10 years finding out if it'll hurt somebody before we apply it, and people die because they could have been helped in art. So they have good intentions, but the bureaucracy tends to grow and grow and grow until You were kicked out of the hospital. You weren't kicked out by the doctors.
No.
You were kicked out by probably some bureaucratic procedure.
Right.
That some official followed.
Right.
Which was absolutely opposite to medical ethics.
I believe you're right.
And it got into the system.
I believe you're right.
And it's awful. And it's not some terrible person there. That's the way centralized systems tend to be. And it's, of course, it has to be stopped.
Well, look, folks, again, to the viewing public out here, you're the voters. I've given you a sampling, if you will, of the kinds of questions you should be asking the folks who are knocking on your door and the folks who are wanting to be representing you. These are the kinds of things that you need to be trying to get a sort of a background of their background to make sure that they're effective and they're going to be responding to the issues that are on your mind. Maybe forget about all of that stuff just coming through the mailing sometimes, because in all due respect, I mean, I can.
Junk mail?
Big time. Big time. Big time aspect of it. So it's a very important.
Yes, we all have to send it. It's awful.
Yeah, it's a very important time in our period at this point in time. We got some very serious problems. Greg's issues aspect of it. We got art here. But look at the background these individuals have. I mean, these folks are educated folks, are willing to get out front and do something. But the bottom line, they can respond to some of the issues. And that's a very, very important piece. So I'm saying to the media also, too, vet the candidates. Vet the candidates. Don't just pick up the ad. Vet the candidates. Make sure that what they're bringing to the table is going to be representation to Oregonians across the board. I don't know if they're going for the dog detail or something, anything. But the bottom line is it's very, very important that we really get the background of these folks. And here's two good examples of what I'm talking about. And especially the guy, he was wearing two hats.
That's right.
Two hats. Not only is he representing the chair, he's chair of the Republican Party, but I'm sure he's vetting some of those candidates that are running on.
So you're wearing two hats in the party yourself.
That's right. That's right.
So
that's
what it's about. This man's wearing two hats, too, because he's a lawyer as well as a citizen.
I have no choice.
Okay, folks.
You have no choice.
Well, thank you very much for being with us. I'll see you next week with another thing. Again, Art.
Thanks.
It's a blessing.
The great.
Take care.
Sounds
great.
Thank you, Bruce.
Okay. Great. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Good night.
Thank you. Thank you.